I must confess, I've actually never owned an original NES. I have a bootleg of the NES Classic somewhere back at my folks' house, but I've never owned the original console. It might seem like such kind of sacrilege for such a self-proclaimed fan of the Mario Brothers series to never own their initial console, but do I really need to? Despite being born 10 years after it came out, our broke asses had a Super Nintendo with Mario All-Stars. Go check the previous video for more details. Which is how I primarily experienced Mario Bros. 1 through 3. But longtime fans are all well aware that all of these games have been available on just about every console henceforth through one way or another. Virtual console, shoddy anniversary collections, online subscriptions, other digital avenues. Sorry, can I rewind the video? I already talked over my punchline here. Let me just... broke asses. There we go. We were hardly people of wealth while I was growing up in Eastern Ontario, so we had to make do with whatever consoles we got as hand-me-downs and gifts. Enter Nintendo Game Boy Advance. Perfect time for me. I was just old enough to understand concepts like personal responsibility and technically proficient enough to blow into my game cartridges when they didn't work. So I was just in time to find myself with a Game Boy Advance. I loved the consoles I had growing up in whatever home I was temporarily in. The Super Nintendo, Nintendo 64, PS2, they're all so hugely nostalgic for me, but totally crushed by the GBA and what it did for me. I lived far, far away from the daycare and schools I attended, so I spent about 40% of the day in the car, to and from daycare and school. The Game Boy Advance being a portable console really helped during that time and steered my thoughts of regret for not unbuckling my seatbelt and throwing myself into traffic when I was 6. I spent hours on so many different games, Sonic Advance, Pokemon, Star Wars Episode 3, but perhaps none more than Mario Advanced. Fun fact, Mario didn't really have an original traditional platformer on the Game Boy Advance. Mario Land 1 and 2 were on the previous Game Boy models, so what'd we get to compensate? We got some bite-sized ports and touch-ups on some Jumpman's most famous adventures. Mario Advance 1 through 4 are such little curious products of their time. Classic Mario games and adventures made portable for the first time was not to love. Well, how often do you see the Advance series brought up in general? Mario World is one of the most beloved games of the decade, if not for the entire video game medium. So why is the modern reaction of its handheld debut so lacking? Are these overlooked gems, or floundering ports that fail to capture the magic of the originals? Let's cut to the chase and jump right in, shall we? Normally, I would show off my copies of the game I'm talking about on my state-of-the-art Android camera, but I don't actually physically own these games anymore. I lost the ones I had years and years ago, and I don't really have the money to be buying the copies off of eBay. Hear my plea and vanquish my suffering! Like this video and subscribe to the channel so you can help me grift and fill my belly with bad eBay purchases. What's that really annoying thing YouTubers keep saying in their videos? Only 99% of my viewers are subscribed, so you have to do it out of guilt. You don't actually have to subscribe, though. I'm thankful you're even watching this far. If you're feeling particularly generous, then you can go through the typical internet diatribe and share the video if you'd like, so I don't have to live with the crumbling horrors of a 9-to-5 and instead make videos about the f***ing Mario Brothers. Anyways, where was I? Right, Game Boy Advance Mario. Let's take a look-see at the very first Mario Advance, something worthy of its grandiose title, a powerful new statement on the original Mario Bros. Game, the one that started it. Mario 2? It's Mario 2? Mario Madness Mario 2? In a shocking first move, the original Mario Bros. Is not the first title of the Advance series, but rather its Americanized sequel chose bravely to lead the way. I hear you asking, what about number 1? Where's the original? Oh, don't worry. Nintendo had other plans for that game, but that's a story for another time. Booting up the game on my 100% legitimate Game Boy Advance, we notice something inherently striking. The color palette. No, there's nothing wrong with their eyes or screen. Subcon just looks like it was flashbang the entire time. This was kind of a necessary evil for console limitations. The original block of cheese GBA model wasn't backlit, so the game had to compensate and become much lighter. I know a lot of people tend to squint their eyes and fall back in revulsion to see Mario in Discord light mode, but I think the style only takes a little bit of adjustment to get used to. And speaking of style, Subcon and its monstrous army has never looked so crisp and full of life. Mario 2 has gone a long way since its debut on the NES and even its Super Nintendo upgrade. The expanded color palette is bulky, More detailed sprites look so excellent on the tiny handheld screen, and you don't really see it too out of place when you blow them up on a computer screen. The four playable character sprites have been given a lot of new features and touches to match with their modern appearances. Hair colors change, sprites' eyes are more detailed. Look at how swanky the super jump is! Gone are the days of just jumping higher. You could now style on Wart and his goons by performing a standing backflip jump that flings you to Mars if you aren't careful. Special mention to the background. I might be the only one to hyperfixate on this franchise enough to notice something like that, but I must simply call attention to it. Every location pops out feels so natural and amusing to roam around in because of the richly detailed sprite art and luscious backgrounds that complement your jumping and vegetable plucking so well. Deep green trees and tranquil blue skies for the relaxing comps in the forest and grasslands. Cracked pottery walls for your time inside jars and fortresses, and starry Arabian nights for the desert levels. Subcontinent's focus on vertical platforming and dark worlds always felt so dreamlike and whimsy. But now I truly believe this is a place conjured by Mario in his sleep. Or maybe it's real, I don't really know what the story is of this game. Sounds like a real winning formula, doesn't it? Brush up a classic game with mostly better graphics, call it a day? Well, it's not quite so simple. Nintendo was ambitious for these releases. This is Mario Advance, not Mario slightly better than the home console version. Someone, some brave soul in the development team decided, let's add voice acting. The results of which? I think it's incredibly charming when Birdo and other bosses take a second to taunt you with deliciously cheesy voice acting, but Nintendo kinda took it to DEFCON 3 with this idea. Every time you pluck a vegetable, get a cherry, do a super jump, they have to announce you with a vocal cue. This is incredibly annoying for a huge amount of people, and I really do understand why. Every single action needing voice acting is pretty damn drastic, especially on the notoriously sound-crunching nature of the Game Boy Advance. Speaking of sound-crunching, let's talk about that soundtrack. Mario 2 tends to be left in the dust in terms of iconic Bing Bing Wahoo music outside of its default overworld theme, but the plucky chiptunes inside this great little bundle of fun really round the whole adventure sharply. The menacing tempo of the approaching boss battle, the whimsy of entering a pot accompanied by the bouncy horns, the vicious beats of Battle Mode all wrapped up in this OST into a cute little package that feels great to listen to on its own. Something I should mention though, do you see the differences between the button layout on the Game Boy Advance and the SNES controller? You know what that means? You guessed it, Subcon is located right next to Georgia. It means you're controlling the game with two buttons, again like the NES days. It took a fair bit to adjust to me, because I was so used to the splendid pleasures of pressing Y and B to control Mario, that going back to A and B feels like my hands are being tied into knots while I try to play. The technological limits have also affected level design somewhat. Given the small screen, the devs had to put a lot less on the screen at once than overwhelm the player with a bunch of enemies and obstacles at once. This applies to all four games sharing the Advanced moniker. I know some would demand Miyamoto be dragged to the pagoda and beheaded for his crimes against platforming, but are you seriously upset that our ninja lines have been slightly reduced? I played this game solid in two sessions for about 3 hours, mostly as Mario and Peach. Toad's a little too slippery still. Playing Luigi in Mario 2 is about as much fun as you'd think it is. Playing as Luigi in Mario 2 is about as much fun as being waterboarded. Finding secret warp pipes was so damn fun. If you haven't played past the first world of Mario 2 like most people, I seriously recommend you boot up this game through totally legal means and give it a shot. If I had infinite time on my hands and the constitution of a saint, I could probably type out a full 8-hour review a la the Omega Ruby review I saw on YouTube once. But I have rent to pay, and if I don't get some kind of pipeline going, I'm going to have my Leaf Overlord a few sob stories to make sure I'm not cruising on the streets of Hamilton homeless. Alright, here's a lightning round. Stuff I noticed that I can't really segment in the script well. Are we going to talk about the fairies that parade Wart's corpse over the place like as the Mushroom Kingdom heroes celebrate their victory? Where are they taking it? My headcanon is that they ate him. They just ate him. Peach's name was properly denoted as Peach instead of Princess Toadstool like the old game, and this carries through all the subsequent games she's in as well. Nintendo also erased any evidence of Brunette Peach, just like Luigi's socks in Mario & Luigi. Luigi is still not fun to play. Fighting Birdo is torture because this big green bean jumps too damn high and doesn't land on any eggs. Having to rescue fairies in a foreign kingdom sounds kind of familiar for a Mario plot, doesn't it? That's because it's basically the same story as 3D World released decades later. Okay, I was gonna make some kind of dumb, ironic joke about Mario 2 not being the original Mario 2, being the English version of Doki Doki Panic, But as I was typing out the joke, my entire Word document crashed and saved none of my progress. So I'm going to take that as a warning sign and just get on to the next game. Now this one, this is a special one. It was the early 2000s. I don't remember how old I was specifically, but I remember my family and I were still living in Eastern Ontario. The twilight of the evening into the night dawned on my adolescent body. My hunger called me. I made a bagel, buttered to perfection in one hand as I ascended upstairs, with a plastic blue Obi-Wan lightsaber in the other. Not sure why I had the lightsaber in the other hand, but what I do know is that none of my hands were on the railing. Old wooden stairs in my home at the time were slippery. My bare foot slipped, and I fell headfirst onto the top step and descended down the staircase like a rolling ball formation. I was bruised up so badly that instead of going to the hospital, my parents offered me a consolation prize, and I got an early present, and it was a copy of Mario World, Mario Advance 2. This is my admission that my review and critique of this specific title is not going to be purely logical. I am heavily nostalgic for this title, and a lot of my comments and praises will probably reflect that. Mario World in all forms is something incredibly dear to me and to many, many other people. Something I can analyze neutrally in this title. Oh my god, look at the title of this game. Mario World, Mario Advance 2. Why is Advance suddenly the subtitle? You didn't see that with the original Advance title. You didn't see it called Mario 2 USA Mario Advance for the Game Boy Advance Definitive Edition featuring Dante from the Devil May Cry series 2.5. Something striking about this game compared to the last is that there's much more of a port than a reimagining. The foundation for Mario World is already mighty solid and insists upon itself, so not much really needed changing when you compare it to its veggie-plucking partner. Rather, it sticks to the tried-and-true formula of its paw-paw game and alters things slightly for the new console. For instance, Luigi is now a full playable character with his own stats and abilities. The two-player mode is gone and replaced with the ability to swap between the bros and the overworld with a click of the R button. He jumps higher and his fireballs actually bounce more than his crimson brothers. I'm not picking him, sorry. Until he gets that goddamn jumping issue fixed, I'm going with Mario. Since this game came out in 2001, it still has the color palette of a Wes Anderson movie because the backlit screens was not a thing yet. It wasn't an issue for me with the previous game, but damn, it really shows now. The original Mario World still cleans up quite nicely on a TV from the 90s and today, which makes the graphical compromise a tough pill to swallow for a lot. I mean, the bushes look like British babies puked up mushy peas for crying out loud. It's hard to appreciate Luigi's custom sprites when everything is washed out and hazy by comparison. Mario 2 and Advance are night and day different because of Advance had so many objective leaps in technology and pixel art, whereas this one kind of suffers from GBA port syndrome, a common but deadly affliction that can cause severe damage to a game's soundtrack and pixel art. And speaking of soundtrack, well, should I even go into detail about it? It's Mario World, but just kind of downscaled. That statement can basically encapsulate this entire game. It's Mario World, but kind of downscaled. From that description, it seems like there isn't even a reason to play the game anymore. I haven't listed a lot of positive features that would stand out from the original release, so what gives? Well, the answer is a bit more complicated. It's an issue of time, and the rapid rate of technological progress. Having a portable Mario World back in 2001 was a novelty so lovely that limitations and drawbacks seemed pretty acceptable, or at least be able to be tolerated. But fast forward to current year, where Nintendo's main console can be a handheld or a home console, whether you lock it in the toaster or not. Most modern phones can run Dolphin at 60 FPS. So having basically any portable device you have can run a Super Nintendo game no problem. Nintendo also released this game on the Wii U Virtual Console for some reason. You don't even need to emulate this game anymore. There are websites that can just play games online to make it even easier. It's not something I can really retroactively blame Advance 2 for, but it is a legitimate reason why someone would want to play this release. Its main gimmick of being portable isn't all that exciting anymore. Right now, it kind of stands as a curious piece of history. If Mario Advance 2 worthy of playing over the original game? That answer depends on what you're explicitly looking for in your playing experience. Personally, I usually end up playing this version because Game Boy Advance ROMs are just so easy to come by. So using any piece of tech, I must emulate it. The whole process takes so little thought that it becomes kind of comforting to me. I'm sure the Super Nintendo version is just as easy to emulate, but the Game Boy Advance is just much more personally nostalgic for me, and that's what it really comes down to. Fundamentally, the games are identical. Advance gives you small little cutscenes in Luigi, but I'm sure a lot of people would see that as a novelty rather than a required function you're missing out by not playing the original release. The button layout isn't too dramatic enough to throw people off a la Mario 64 and Mario 64 DS. It's pretty minor. So you have to ask yourself, are you okay with minor changes made to the original game? You asked for it, here's it back. Here's the lightning round for Mario World. Luigi is actually a little bit fun to play this time, I kind of lied. His wacky control scheme meshes a lot more naturally into the level design of this game than whatever Subcon had to offer. So a round of applause for Luigi. For the first time, he is fun to play. I never actually beat this game as a child. I always got stuck in one of the castles and got hard filtered until I lost the game sometime later. They actually made new Luigi sprites for this game. The Mario World Plus All-Stars game for the Super Nintendo had Luigi, but they specifically felt the need to create new highlighting sprites, which is so cool. I really don't understand what's so advanced about this release. I demand Nintendo explain to me why such minor change justifies advance. What is advance? The console? And speaking of minor changes, Yoshi's Island, Mario Advance 3. This is not the worst title in the series, we will get to that, but this is pretty dumb. So, if we're keeping track, Mario 2, Mario World, now Mario World 2, Yoshi's Island is the order. I'm sorry, that's just silly. Who is deciding these names, Nomura? This follows a similar beat to the previous game, acting more as a port than an enhanced version of an older game, except even more of a port. Advance 3 is almost one-to-one with Yoshi's Island, which means I don't really have a lot to say with it, because I don't like the original Yoshi's Island. Just make a thread about me already. I'm much more partial to Yoshi's Island DS myself, but I can't really get into other Yoshi games. I don't play games for 7-year-olds. I play mature, rated E10 and up games, thank you very much. I won't claim to be too good for these platformer games, but something about it just feels a little too simplistic. It just doesn't scratch the itch like Mario does. I'll stop beating around the bush and get to brass tacks. I don't really feel like playing this game that much. As far as I got head to toe, it's just Yoshi's Island, but with signature puke green of the GBA color palette and controls a little bit more awkwardly because of two buttons. Describe me, it would just be repeating myself and artificially extending the video length. What I can do is discuss features I neglected to talk about while have footage running in the background. All full Mario Advance games came with the same secondary game, a remake of the original Mario Bros. Arcade game. You run, jump, stomp on Koombas, and get bored 10 minutes in and turn it off. The intended function was to have all four carts having the same game and lets you connect a GBA link cable with another player, which lets two people control one bro at a time, regardless of which advanced game you happen to own. I love this idea. I think it's such a stellar example of how multiplayer should be encouraged. You aren't forced to have two copies of the same game in order to play, and it was supported through the entire lineup of advanced games. Granted, it's still just Mario Bros., but it's a wonderful example of how long-term, consistent planning between all four games. If Nintendo, for some reason, put Game Freak behind these remakes, they'd probably neglect to include the save function because the original releases didn't have them. Speaking of the save function, actually, there is one. We have a save function. All four games can save. Depending on the game, all you need to do is pause and just save your progress on a level. Works differently for each game because there's no hub world in Mario Advance 1, so you just save. Every other subsequent release just save on the map. I don't really appreciate the feature much as now, because when I play on a legit Game Boy Advance on an emulator, my legit Game Boy Advance on an emulator has save states that perform the same function but even easier. But it was such a godsend when I was playing these for the first time as a kid. I hated how old games didn't let you save or had very limited saves, so adding a whole new system made me feel so much more accomplished whenever I played and shut off the game, knowing I can just pick up where I left tomorrow. I suppose that's kind of a quirk of modern gaming. Game Boy Advance carts might have been a bit spotty, but they were well built for what they were, as long as you weren't using those cheap-ass batteries Game Freak had for Pokemon Emerald. Short segment? Don't even worry about it. I got another lightning round right for you. I actually never owned this game. Beyond this point, any nostalgic territory leaves and I get to experience this game through a legit GBA, not an emulator. Fun fact, this was one of the games to be given through the 3DS Ambassador Program, something Nintendo had to do for the people who had the privilege of buying the 3DS before its historic price slash. The Wii U got it a couple years later as a standard virtual console release, but the 3DS only had this game for ambassadors and they never put it on otherwise. This one might be on me, but I never got the hubbub about the final boss of this game. it's just fine. People online seem to call it one of the best boss fights in the history of gaming. It's not even top 10 Mario boss battles, let alone medium defining boss battles. What are you smoking? Who do you think you are, Yoshi's Island? Trail in the Sky, second chapter? You're out to lunch. This fight is not all that in a bag of chips. Get the hell out of here. You're relevant. So, we've checked all other boxes. We've discussed the marvelous first game, the pleasant port jobs of 2 and 3, but nothing. And I do mean nothing at all. Comes close to matching what Mario Bros. 3, Mario Advance 4, has done for this nation and her people. God bless America. We finally entered the year of 2003, and backlit Game Boy Advances were now a thing. Just take a look at these colors! Gone are the days of baby pastel colors. This is a full-blown remake in your pockets, ladies and gentlemen. A lovely assortment of earthy browns, warm reds, gorgeously opaque blue skies make this release a lovely sight on the eyes. It's how Mario 3 definitively looks. Definitive. That's what you want to keep in mind. It's the perfect word to describe this release. With every other title, there were bells and whistles on each separate variation in gameplay methods that allowed some degree of disagreements which one was the best. Here, no contest. Mario 3 has never looked and played smoother until this game. And everyone knows it. Nintendo knows how well they crafted this bad boy, because they keep releasing them every subsequent console. It's so advanced, you have to change the save memory type on your legit GBA, not an emulator. It's crazy. But I think we all know this game has a little bit of skeletons in its closet. We don't want to admit it, but it's hiding something. Something that would make you question everything. Something devious. Something diabolical. The e-reader. The Nintendo GBA e-reader was a seldomly used device, most fondly remembered as the number one contributor to wasted plastic and the bane of every Pokemon fan's existence. How it worked is we swiped cards across its little surface to activate certain features in a game, and Mario 3 made very interesting use of it. Entire levels, worlds, were locked behind these cards. Have you ever wanted to use the cape feather in Mario 3? Have you ever wanted to throw vegetables and beat Luigi to death with a turnip? All e-reader features. You want to find all these features today on a legit GBA? You'd have better luck finding a pre-2010 Ford F-150 for a reasonable price and getting all that. The e-reader, the required cards, the Game Boy Advance to play it on? I would highly recommend getting a Wii U and putting custom firmware to get the now defunct virtual console, because it has all the content restored and playable without any additives. You could use Switch Online, play it like a chump subscription service. You really wanted to. Mario 3 in general is kind of an odd case for me. It's the least nostalgic out of the original trilogy. I only ever played it on the Wii's virtual console years later, and something just made me feel funny. It's a moot point now, but look at the platforms. Everything bolted to the walls and ceilings in this play performance platformer. I know it's been confirmed after so many years, but something kind of bugs me. Mario entering hell at the end, the ghoulish theme of the airship armadas pounding through these make-believe kingdoms, the monarchs of the kingdoms being turned into animals to the accursed black arts of the Koopa clan. This game is goetic. It is a smoldering Baphomet perched high in the clouds, flaunting its false exaltation while skeletal arms drag you down to gnashing teeth and weeping. Save your tears, plumber, for you may only quench the thirst of dry bones now. Rattle in terror and pray for forgiveness from the Lord thy God, whom brought you from Brooklyn, and perhaps he is most high will ensure your immortal soul. AVGN's video was not a joke. It was prophetic. May Super Mega Death Christ be with us all. Anyways, what was I saying? Oh yeah, Mario 3. This finally marks the end of the proper Mario Advance quadrilogy. Four games crunched and brought down to a portable console. All bases covered and considered, I think some of these hold up pretty well. 1 and 4 are absolutely least a very interesting piece of history to give a play, but 2 and 3 kind of suffer from GBA port syndrome, so those two aren't ones I would recommend you jump on and try right away. Oh yeah, Mario Party Advanced. I'm sorry, I don't really care about Mario Party that much. When they start doing Jackass stunts, count me in.
Hi, I'm Johnny Knoxville. Welcome to Jackass.
I think I should probably start wrapping things up by now. I could say more and give each game a super in-depth review, but this video is kind of long. Long since delayed from when I initially planned to release this in early March. You know, sometimes your car just breaks down, you move houses, then you lose everything and your whole life falls apart and you have to record in a closet. You never know. I feel like I've been catching up on so many promises for consistent uploading and scheduling, but I mean it this time. I've moved in, I have a setup, I just need to do it. I fully plan to throw myself into this and not make it a hobby, but a long, wonderful career. But I can only do that with loyal and loving support. By all means, if you want more of me and my rambunctious babbling, you had better like this video, subscribe to the channel, and stay tuned. If you don't want me around and you hate my videos, go dox my information, try and kill me or something, I don't know. Until then, have a wonderful rest of your day.